bit crazy. Keep it simple. Keep it safe. Let's get into these bans. So Azir and Aurelia obviously aimed at Smitty J, not the Azir, that's aimed at Knight. And Vladimir.
Unless secrets.
Maybe
surprises.
He's got the top lane Azir ready to bust out. But no, Vladimir is going to be banned away. Chen as well. Two interesting bans there, as Vladimir was 100% ban all picked so far in 6-12, of course, last week.
Yeah, and it was funny because we talked about it coming into the week, how Vladimir was, he was broken. Like, he's just too good. Mm-hmm. And the teams were like, we let him through, you know, a few times, and every time, he won. Yeah. 6-0 last week, and every time the player said, yeah, he's too good, you know, we couldn't deal with him. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you can debate, do we have the right counter picks in Europe for him? Maybe not, if you look at other regions, but not relevant for this game because he is taken away.
Yep, nope. Olaf also bans, 12 bans on him so far. Trundle as well, and that will round out the bans. You can see the quick hover there on Jace, the Parang special. He brought that out once and still lost the game.
All right, what do you want to see here, boss? What do you want to see?
I want to see Jace from Parang.
We don't want to see Jace first pick. Karma obviously has been a very staple early pick for a lot of teams. You can flex it, mm-hmm. So that's very strong. 80 carry picks, we've actually seen Caitlyn.
She's been banned a lot.
Been banned and then picked very early in the draft as well. Nidalee is open. We know Maxlaw likes to play it. LX, he is an aggressive early jungler, but he's obviously... It feels like you always prioritize different picks than just in Italy, and this is interesting.
Rek'Sai, okay, so woo-hoo! Swain gonna be picked up, and that's been banned out a bunch against Rocket, all because of Betty. 11 bans on him, and Betty has had some killer Swain performances, so you can understand why, but yeah, easy early pickup for Rocket.
But man, that's a first pick in Europe we don't see, mm-hmm. Unless it's Rocket playing. Like, they're the only team keeping that Swain banner lifted, keeping alive, basically, because I actually think after his nerfs, he's not that strong of a pick. I think he's a snowball pick, right? If he does well early, he's fantastic.
Yeah.
He doesn't want to go full late game necessarily, but he needs a good start. And Giants have now tons of time to draft around this Swain. Remember, he can go top lane. He can go top lane if you want to play like a melee champion.
Yeah, I feel very unlikely with Betty on the team and Parang
sure,
being in the top laner,
fair.
But yes, I believe that is a possibility. Jhin's going to be picked up here, given to Sunstar. Actually funny, some of the weaker performing ADCs in the league have been picking up Jhin, and who is not an easy champion to play and doing really well with him. So going to be picking that early on to the draft along with Braum. So bot lane locked in here for Giants, not prioritizing the jungler perhaps for Maxlaw.
And that's again why this Swain pick is, to me, very surprising, because I actually don't think Giants would have picked it. Mm. At least again, if you follow last week's trends, we're on the same patch, 6.12, we haven't switched yet. Like, no other team really looked at Swain that much. We saw him a few times here and there. So Giants get two comfort picks. Hustlin on Braum, it's great for him, he likes to play these tanky melee supports. Yep. And obviously, as you talked about, the Jhin for Sunstar. So I feel like Giants are getting a good start in this pick and ban phase because Rocket put so much focus on Swain.
For sure. There's the Lucian pickup coming in here for Steelback and Hecarim as well. Most likely going in the jungle here. Can also go top lane, but we're seeing it out of jungle mostly.
Yeah. Also, Airwax played it already in the jungle. Fun lineup. Very tanky already from Rocket. If it's Hecarim jungle, Swain mid lane, a Bruiser or tank top lane, like that's like a beefy, beefy lineup. And Giants will need some damage to break through. Hecarim is fantastic once he gets Cinderhulk and one item extra completed. He becomes extremely strong. But he's not really the jungler who snowballs your Swain in the early game. So I would like to see an early game jungler from Giants who can gank. Rek'Sai could work. Elise is fantastic for early game pressure. And then you try and camp the Swain. I think that's the way to play this. H2K showed it last week when they played against the Swain in mid. They're like, all right. Like a Kindred, gank level 3 mid lane and just camp that mid lane.
Come
and Swain fell behind.
Come on, Knight, lock it. You know you want
you
to.
You can do it.
We've seen a Cassiopeia once so far in European LCS. NA's picked a bunch. And it is a Knight signature pick, so he's going to lock it in. Really good to see this. There was a lot of hype around him coming into the league. There's like highlight clips everywhere of him on his Cassiopeia, his Zillion. We really wanted to see it. And now he's bringing it out, so I'm pretty happy to see this one.
Yeah, he's a master of the Cassiopeia ulti into flash, mm-hmm. So there's no reaction time really from the other team. Instantly you will get stunned. Great pick for him. And yes, it's a pick North America really likes. Other regions have been using it more and more. A few times in Europe as well, a bit like Swain. We just see him a few times here and there. Not really become a stable pick yet. But I do think this is a very, very good draft right now from Giants. Cassiopeia has a good laning phase. Not as strong as the Swain straight up. Mm-hmm. But when you compare that with when you pair it with a Rek'Sai, there are room for early ganks, early pressure around the mid lane.
We'll definitely like to see that coming up from Maxer, and he has generally put a lot of pressure towards the mid lane, or whoever is winning. And well, we've got the hovers so far here, Deficio. And that's going to be locked in. So there's the Karma actually making it very far through the picks and bans. Usually we see Karma as a very early pick. Lissandra also picked up, so you would assume... Well, actually, that could go either way.
They can both go top.
Yeah.
So they're trying to bait Giants a little bit, but you know it's an AP range top laner. Mm. Meaning that a pick like the good old Tryndamere probably won't work very well. But if you can pick something like a Gnar, who's very safe, at least once he hits a few levels, farm from range, that could be an option. You can pick a pure tank as well. Swain will be able to beat you in the laning phase, especially if he gets the 1v1. So I actually want to see what Smitty J wants to pick. I think this is okay from Rocket, because they're trying to target a big part of Giant's strategy, which is Smitty J on a split pusher where he gets ahead early on. Like with the ban of Olaf, Irelia, Trundle ban on the side of Giants. Rumble being locked in.
Wow, okay, cool. Seeing him in Europe, haven't seen him last week. We did see him in some of the Asian regions, but not really in Europe just yet. So interesting to see that one. Saw it like once or twice in Challenger, I believe, but not in the LCS. That's going to be going up against what you would assume is a Lissandra. They still have a little bit, 20 seconds to swap around these mid and top picks.
See, this is where, Pulse, I'm very, very happy to follow other regions because a lot of these picks look a bit like new in Europe. Hecarim still hasn't been played that much in Europe yet. Lissandra top lane, Rumble being back, Cassiopeia being used. So if you only watch the ULCS, there's a lot of picks here where you're like, oh, okay, surprising.
Right, crazy.
Yeah, crazy. I didn't expect all these picks to come in here. But around the world, especially in Korea, a lot of Rumble is being played. Protobelt as your first item. It's very, very strong. You have a lot of mid-game damage. So I'm very excited for these comps because you cannot play a slow game with these team comps. Like, this will be crazy fighting in the mid game with Lissandra, who's strong in the mid game. Rumble is fantastic in the mid game. Like, if we get a 40-minute game where nothing happens, both teams are playing it wrong.
Yeah, I'd be very surprised as well with Giants, who generally do get up and personal with their opponents, and maybe
they want to
pull them closing out. But Rocket as well have traditionally had a weaker early game, but their late game team fighting has been generally on point. But there we have the full composition. So jump on Twitter, use the hashtags ROCWin, DIAWin, and we'll see what you guys are thinking about these compositions and this game as we head into this one. First game of the day here in the studio. This one should be fun indeed with these compositions. Rocket versus Giants.
Some great reading there, Pulse.
Reading from what, Deficio?
If it's in the prompter, you gotta read it, man. That's how it goes.
We so had scripted.
A little run Virgin Team moment. Sadly, we didn't get it.
Yeah,
maybe
not
next
today.
Time.
Someone will put the question mark in there eventually, but do you have some question marks on this game? I'm Richard Paul's cam. There you go. LX coming out here with the Hecarim. As you mentioned, haven't seen a ton of Hecarim, but he's been seeing it more than the Rumble and the Cassiopeia coming out here.
Definitely, yeah. He actually wasn't very successful last week in Europe. He fell behind in most of the games. He is a jungler that can be punished in the early stages of the game. Mm. Not that much by Rek'Sai. It's more if you put like Nidalee or Elise against it, you can really invade and punish him. I think this is perfectly fine for LX. You have a matchup where both junglers can scale, but mainly the Hecarim can get a great mid game off. Like, give him two items. If he gets ahead early, give him a Trinity Force and he's a monster. But again, like, we got mid game focused top laners, Rumble and Lissandra. You have strong engage on the side of Rocket. Not a composition where you sit for 30 minutes and do nothing. Like, they have been doing in the past. Like, you play aggressive with these kind of comps. You have strong laning from Swain. I'm super excited for these pick and ban phases here, so definitely watch this game because there will be a lot of stuff going on.
I am watching it, Deficio.
Are you watching
it? I'm also looking at the keystones coming in for Sunstone. We were having a discussion off air about Jhin and the two choices you can make. That's very annoying to me. But Thunderlords and Deathfire Touch.
Yes.
And the benefits of each. Obviously, you get more burst with Thunderlords.
More burst. Thunderlords is more damage in the early to mid game as well until you get a ton of AD. And there's another reason you go for Thunderlords. It's because on the way to the Keystone, you can get flat armor penetration in the Cunning Tree, which is super, super useful when you already build flat penetration. You want as much as possible, obviously, from Sunstar. A lot of Korean Jhins also go armor penetration runes. Mm-hmm. Which is
and indeed
even
Sunstar
better.
is running armor penetration. All right. So there we go.
So we get armor penetration talents, we get armor penetration build, and armor penetration runes from this Jhin.
Mm, talents.
Talents, man.
Yeah. Get those talents in. But yeah.
He is against two champions who will build Hourglass, where obviously that will ruin the fun a little bit for Sunstar. We know Eric's will go tank, and look at this, boys. We got new toys in Europe.
Yes, we do. There's the lane swap cam, so we can see exactly when the towers go down and if any advantage to go to either team. And we'll keep a track on that. It is, of course, a lane swap, so you guys know the draw by now here in Europe for sure. But looking towards this mid lane, Cassiope has a pretty decent laning phase. She last hits very easy. Basically, Annie on steroids with just lasting with E because you get the mana back.
One of the best changes, by the way. You don't need the poison down chains. Yeah, just hit puberty here, so give me a bit of time, please.
Yep, no problem. And, yeah, Betsy as well. See if we can just get a little further into this game because mid-game Swain with a couple items, very scary. That was very brave of Betsy, taking a lot of those Twin Fangs on the retreat there from Knight.
But I feel like, I mean, both teams again mid-game have a lot of power. Once you get Rod of Ages in tier, or actually once you get tier on Cassiopeia, you can start trading so effectively, you almost get mana back. It's just that strong on her with the dealing damage part because you can spam E again, you don't need the poisons down necessarily. So you are actually very, very good at fighting in the mid-game. Both team comps are Karma, it's fantastic laning support, obviously. Even have decent base damage in the mid-game. So a lot of good things to look at, but let's take a look at just the comps, right?
All right.
Just the comps. We go back. Is this a lane swap? Teams are just going to swap
around.
Put
your hands over the middle of the screen.
Put my hands in the middle of the screen here. Obviously, mixed damage from both. Not really a surprise. No one is running a massive front line either. It's very explosive instead, like Lissandra, Rumble. These champions who can buy a bit of time, but they're not tanks. Mm. It's Hecarim who's a tank, it's Rek'Sai who's a tank. That's it. And then Swain, we know, wants to buy tons of time in these fights. So we might have one of these games where if one team starts getting ahead in the mid-game, they just snowball out of control. Everyone else is too squishy, there's too much damage on the other side, and go for both teams, and they just run over the other team.
So, something I think about sometimes, DeFisio, is someone places down a ward in front of you. It is you, but also on top of thinking about you, DeFisio, I look at people clearing out wards when you know you don't have enough attack speed in the early game, and they go for it anyway. They get the two hits, and they'll never come back.
Frustration.
Yeah. Because Airwax was like, I'm going to stick around here for an extra 2 seconds to hit this. I know I'm not going to kill it. And I'm going to back away and never come back top again.
Maybe he's used to running like tons of attack speed runes, and he would actually kill it. And then he picked a different rune page.
I mean, you know you need more than 0.8 attack speed to clear it
tons
out.
Tons of attack speed
yeah.
to clear it out. But we do see this lane swap ended very early. And Airwax, he's ghosting up.
He's going to come here onto Smitty. Jay, Parang is out of range, and he will flash away. So, burning the flash in the top lane. Parang was very far back, though. I feel like Smitty Jay is probably just going to be knocked back to his tower by Airwax.
Well, I actually quite like the gank, at least just to force the flash. Mm. Like, no reason to take a chance. And because the wave was pushing towards Parang, Smitty Jay had to overextend with no tower behind him. Because what happened in this game was both teams, after having the lane swap, were ready to take standard lanes. So Rocket actually sent their dual lane to the bottom side, Giants return to the bottom side as well, meaning now we have a situation where two lanes don't have a tower to protect them. Top lane means you can gank easy, bot lane means you can TP gank, but it's a Rumble right now who is not even close to level 6, so your TP ganking is not very effective, meaning that Giants probably won't be able to really take advantage of Rocket lacking a tower, right now at least.
Yeah, I want to see if Giants can get good setup for their fights and how they get the TPs down. Because it's a lot harder to TP in as Rumble as it is like with Lissandra or like a tank. You can't just TP in the middle of the team, then instantly ult, because you'll get popped instantly if you don't have Zhonya's Hourglass. And Rumble typically doesn't go for that early. He goes for Protobelt and Spell Penetration. So it's really down to Giants to get good wards for him where he's kind of in fog. That would be optimal to land the Equalizer from out of range.
Yeah, that's a big problem for Giants overall is they don't run engage in this composition. So it's kind of comes where if you're not at the objective first, you often can't even fight for it. Because you have to then like run through with a Jhin, with a Cassiopeia here. Can't really get close enough without getting flanked by Lissandra, and then the fight is over, Hecarim flying over the wall. So Giants need to always be proactive, always be there first to set up the objectives. But they also have what I call a bit of a siege composition. I think the new Cassiopeia is actually really good in siege comps because of a new W. Mm-hmm. Miasma here that covers such a large part of the map. Had a lot of fun with that one last week, but we won't repeat that. So because you can cover so much ground with the W, And then it actually sets up the Jhin W as well with the snare. So you can start sieging on these objectives and towers. Very, very effective. But there's enough engage on Rocket to always jump Giants when they're trying to set up a siege. So it's a difficult comp for Giants to execute. Where I feel like Rockets is a little bit more simple in how you want to play. TP in Lissandra, she's your main engage, then follow up from the Hecarim, and the fight is on.
Yeah, I feel so often with Hecarims that we're seeing recently, even though we haven't seen a lot of them, where he's generally going in as like primary engage and also behind, so he just goes in,
and
ults
dies
instantly. But Airwax is having a pretty smooth early game here, so should be able to get towards one item, two item a lot faster.
It's what we talked about, right? Rek'Sai won't really pressure Hecarim that much early. It needs to be in Elise or in Italy. Picks like these that can really bully early on. Airwax doesn't have, he does have his ghost one more time. A new ping has been set up by Parang, so they're trying to be a bit annoying against Smitty J. Whenever this lane is pushing towards Parang, Airwax is here every time. So this is not Smitty J playing poorly. That's not why he's losing this lane at the moment or losing the pressure in the lane. It's because Rocket is setting up to gank him every time.
Yeah, I actually like that from Smitty. Just popping the ult there so he can go back to base, knowing that there could be a gank around the corner. Knowing that Airwax could be there, which he was right in this case, so it worked out. So we'll go back to base, and ultimately he's not going to be engaging with it anytime soon, really. First Dragon is also Cloud Dragon, so it's not like he has to go bot lane immediately.
Oh my god, the Cloud Dragon.
That.
It's getting buffed.
It is, yes. But also because of how diminishing returns work, and also still being out of combat. We'll see how it works, but that is 6:13, and we are on 6:12. I said that very Australian for some reason. Max Lord,
13.
Coming out here. 13. Betsy, she's gonna get a good Never move, and that was not a good ult there from Knight. Gonna get the knock up though from Maxwell. A flashback from Betsy, and the Twin Fangs will follow up. The poison damage is huge, and that'll be first blood.
I really like this. When you play against the Swain, we know how good he is in the early game and how he needs to snowball. Just early gank him. Would have liked to see an even earlier gank, but this is perfectly fine.
Yeah,
good setup and good trading.
Also feels really good when you miss all of your skill shots and then hit all of the point and click abilities and you still get the kill.
He got the slowdown. He got the slowdown.
And then he was like, Twin Fang, Flash Ignite. Maxlaw, however, got the sick knockup. So they burnt a lot of resources from that, but Betsy, of course, used both his summoners and also died. So pretty good turnout for Giants. But take a look at this from Knight.
Yeah, again, so he ends up not getting the stun on his ulti, but you have enough damage at this point. That's what Giant knows here, okay? As soon as you get the knockup in, well, you have the damage. Just follow up. Easy to spam Twin Fangs on this Swain here. I just want to see a follow-up now from Airwax. You know, you have a Cassiopeia with no flash in the mid lane against the Swain. That's where the Hecarim can strike easily.
Yeah.
Lissandra can TP in easily, and you can just collapse on Knight. Betsy's always pushing the lane, trying to use the bird to like harass on the tower. But this means Knight won't get ganked. So for now, it's fine. Like, Cassiopeia is one of the best champions at lasting on the tower. Like, it's almost impossible to fail.
Yeah, can confirm.
Because you failed it, or?
No, because I hit all of them. It's so easy. It's just like E, 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 everything down.
E, there we go.
Yeah, that's all you have to do. And because it does so much damage at this stage, because he's got 5 points in it, literally you can just wait for tower shot to hit it once, and you can kill the minion. Poison damage is really significant now, but it's less forgiving. It's actually really nice with the changes to Cass.
Airwax agrees here. He's setting up for a gank. Maxlaw is around. Spots him.
Prey has been sought out.
I think Airwax was moving around in the bush.
Okay, for the tremor sense.
Right. Yeah, I think he got spotted first, and that's why Maxlaw.
The sickest read of all time.
Exactly. Yeah, he was like, oh yeah, I know exactly where he's going to be. Well, to be fair, he knew a gank was likely to happen in the mid lane, and then you just kind of 50-50 on a bush.
That's still good. I was impressed. I was just like, man, he must be the worst person to play Battleships against, because you know where everything is before you even start. But Sunstar...
He was cheating.
He's been cheating all along. Maxlaw, he's going down here, clearing out the ward, clearing out the... I'm not sure what that was about. Either he missed the Scorecrab or was trying to Winter's bite the ward. But either way...
Oh, he steals it!
Stolen away.
Small things to get hyped about.
Raise.
It's not over yet,
Pulse. He's between a Rek'Sai and a hard place. Here comes Steel back, and they're both going to get knocked up here. Good long range ultimate. Here comes Steel coming in from Jhin as well, following on to Steel back. Look at that fourth shot to land onto Parang, and he'll back away. Nice kill by Giants.
And this is what we mentioned like a few minutes ago, how there's no tower behind Rocket in the bottom lane, so that sets up a TP from the Rumble. A little bit of a different situation. Airwax, nah, he's fine, he's baiting.
He's okay.
He wants to show his horse here, and he loses his red buff forward. Giants with control, good setup. Race getting jumped on. And remember, Pulse.
Okay, what am I remembering?
Do you need to remember that Sunstar is getting ganked?
He is. Airwax is coming in. Sunstar's got the Swag Walk. That really didn't do as much damage as he wanted it to. Onslaught of Shadows will follow Sunstar afterwards and still get the fear down. Here comes Barang. Steel back with the kill.
Got to flash to the side if you want to dodge that. But then again, it's almost impossible. In the end, he flashed, forced Airwax to use the ulti. Small things, just ganks here and there. So Race looks good. You know, he steals it. Problem for him is Max Law is already behind him at this point. Ward being placed down, and at this point, you're not really getting out of this one. And there's go down. So good little setup from Giants. Didn't get enough. Didn't get enough because your second reward is a Cloud Drake. Which they didn't even kill, did they? Nope.
Kill what?
Nope, didn't even kill the Cloud Drake.
No, they did not. So Cloud Drake lives another day. Is doing very well. He's been living for a long time, 30 minutes.
Funny enough, I mean, just to jump at that point, what, the Drake that's always alive the longest? All right, Jeopardy time here.
Okay, all right.
Take a crazy guess.
What am I guessing? You haven't given me
time. Yeah, no.
Okay, okay.
This dragon is always alive the longest. Mm-hmm. So now you gotta be like, beep.
Oh, I'll take it for 100 points. It's not very good compared to the rest of the dragons.
You forgot to say what is.
Infernal, very good for snowballing. Mountain Dragon.
You are so bad at Jeopardy, it's insane.
What?
You're supposed to say, what is the Cloud Drake?
Oh.
Because it's alive the longest,
yeah,
because no one wants to kill it.
Yeah, I messed it up, sorry.
And you also didn't press your button, I did it for you.
Well, that's fine, I was already buzzed in, you can buzz it again. It's not how you do it.
All right, that went terribly wrong.
Yeah,
we should practice
badly.
That one for next time.
We should. We still got the answer, though.
Yes, Cloud Drake is, on average, alive much longer than other Drakes. A lot of the times, Drakes will go down within a minute of spawning. Not the first Drake, but then the second, mm-hmm. third, fourth, and so on. Because people really want to get these nice, fancy Drakes. And now we get a swap, Pulse Arena. Delayed lane swap.
We do.
Doesn't count as a lane swap, but we call
we'll
that
call
anyway.
That, yeah. Ray's going to take a tower shot. And Smitty, he's just dancing back and forth. He's not really under pressure of dying here, but Giants will get the tower first in the bot side. Yeah, Smitty's already used his ultimate, so this tower will also go down. So we're just going to see a simple trade here. What does that mean from here? Can either team capitalize and do anything more, or is it just a tower trade?
I mean, again, naturally, you start either looking at mid lane or you look at the objective in the river just behind where you pushed. So for Giants, it would be the Dragon. For Rocket, it would be the Rift Herald. But in this situation here, none of the teams really benefit from Rift Herald because you are playing these team fighting mages here and not really split pushers.
Yeah,
specifically.
Rumble not really known for his split push.
And also, none of the teams really want the Cloud Drake, so they're kind of like, meh, yeah. We don't want our prize. It kind of is a sucky one. So instead, they hovered around mid and they're like, all right, pretty obvious that mm-hmm. we're all mid now. And then everyone just kind of backs away from it. So it's fun to see how none of them really want the river objectives. I do think at this point, you take the Cloud Drake to see what the next one is.
Yeah.
Especially if you're Giants and you had a good start, like your Rumble. Yes, he was under pressure because he was stuck in a 1v1 lane with no tower, but he's been doing just fine. He has his protocol completed. He's getting very strong towards the mid game. And you have this armor penetration Jhin. I think if you're Giants, you are ready to fight. And that's why taking a dragon to just get the next one spawning can really benefit you and sets up an easy objective to force a fight around.
I'm sad to Fisher because you promised me an exciting lot of kills in the early game.
It will happen.
It will happen.
In the mid game.
In the mid game.
We're mid game now. 50 minutes is pretty much mid game.
We can call it. Yeah, yeah, we're basically out of laning phase.
Otherwise, we just make up our own words here. We don't care.
It's absolutely fine. Giants are going to take the top tower. I'm going to see a trade in the bottom side as well. So once again, just trading towers. And I think you're right. I would like to see someone take the Cloud Dragon right now, just so we get another one, which will be Cloud again. And then the teams will just back away.
But then it's not as bad if you start getting two or three of them. You just wish it was something else. But once you start stacking them, they actually do give
really
you
good.
Some bonuses. Giants are a little bit slow in this push here, so they're actually allowing Rocket to get a lot of damage on tower. This was a very poor decision from Giants. They were far behind on the play. And now they're just leaving Sunstar, meaning Perrin can recall and actually just catch this wave. Sunstar won't be able to kill it in time. And yeah, Rocket definitely wins out on this small trade.
Yeah, screw that one up. Weird as well, because they managed to take the tower first. And then they were like, all right, good job, guys. Back to base. That was a good day's work.
I'm like, wait a minute. No, don't back to base. I'm like, oh, now we already start recall, and now we're a little bit too late. And instead, Pulse Arena, we are setting up four Mid-game fights.
Mid-game fights.
Get
I
hyped.
Wish everyone at home could have seen that dance that you did because it was fantastic.
I am not a dancer.
Come into this mid lane. Does not land the W, but will land the ultimate. Maxwell is going to come in here as well, but it's not enough damage and will be blocked out by the shield. Rockhead coming out here to save Betsy's life. So good attempt by Giants, but didn't pan out in the end.
I like the play again, though. Giants have been controlling, especially the bottom side. River, so set up another gank on Betsy. Double summoner's blown, he's back to base, or well, he should go back to base very soon. He's recalling now. That could set up your dragon. Or it forces Rocket into a very bad team fight. So I really like the play. Maxlaw is constantly in the jungle of Airwex. Finds him.
Yep, he's gonna get the knockup, but he is Rek'Sai versus Hecarim. So Hecarim's gonna hit E, and Rek'Sai doesn't have enough damage from Queen's Wrath, so he's just gonna walk away on all fours, and go back into the mid lane. So nothing really there. We do have some items being picked up though. Double Rod of Ages, of course, from Rockhat. At some point, they probably will go for the Zonya's Hourglass, but not right now, because Spectre's Cow is being picked up by Betsy. To get of the double AP threats in the mid game from Knight and Smitty. you already mentioned Fred about, so. What are you giggling
no
about?
No one wants to take this dragon.
Well, no, it's
just
Cloud
take
Dragon.
It so we can see the next one. Again, both teams want to fight around these objectives. One team wants to flank. On it, the other team wants to sit up and force you to run at them so mm-hmm. they can lay down Cassiopeia W, Snare from Jhin, Ulti from Rumble. Like, you have an insane comp if you're Giants, if the other team is forced to engage on you. Mm-hmm. Don't put yourself in a situation where your only win condition will be Baron setups. That's why getting these early dragons is good, no matter which dragon it is. Just get a few of them, because suddenly when the Elder Drake starts spawning, that's a second way for you to win games with these kind of comps. Because Giants obviously can start sieging and use this Jhin mm-hmm. W with the Cassiopeia W we talked about. But it's so much harder because you need to be aware of every single ward around you. Because if there's a ward behind you, Lissandro TP is in, Hecarim comes flying in with it, and then suddenly you lose the team fight. So it's very, very difficult for Giants when you have to ward both sides.
Yeah. I mean, that's what we spoke about early on to the game, right? Well, Giants actually have the warding setup, and right now they just don't feel confident in themselves that they have the warding setup. So that's why we're getting this little bit of lag here, because if they did go for it and pull the trigger right now, Rocket have two good wards behind them at Dragon if they decided to go in. So actually, it would not be good, because Prank will get the ultimate of the century. Mid lane is now being sieged in, but the minions are quickly dying. And there was a small trap set up as well by Sunstar, so Rocket do back away, but get a bit of chip damage on the mid lane. But Knight and Smitty are coming in from both sides, but I mean, there's still a tower there, so not looking for the dive right now. And we are stalling out, my friend.
We are definitely stalling out, but remember, these are two teams who really, really want to win this game because they're down in the bottom half of our standings, mm-hmm. and it's all about avoiding promotion tournament. So I'm not surprised to see two teams not risking it. Yeah, you can maybe say it's a lack in confidence. They just gotta get out there, man, you know? Meet some people.
Yeah, get out in the world. The world is your oyster.
Get out there,
man. Make some contacts.
Yeah, fight people in the game, not in real life. And again, it makes sense. If you get a 2-0 here for either team, it's fantastic. You start creating some distance between you and the other bottom half teams.
Yeah.
No one wants to sit as number 10. And right now it is Rocket, technically, even though they're actually on 7 points, like Giants, like Unicorns are as well, and like Origin are. They're
exactly.
all one big happy or sad group.
One big sad family, trying to get some points, trying to
the siege
get
pulse.
Out. The siege.
Wait
the
for
siege
W.
From,
wait for W from Cassiopeia.
From Knight. Yeah, he'll place it behind the tower and try and zone away Rocket. Kind of the mid lane, the Caitlyn of mid lane. But he's not going to do it right now. It's actually really good. We did some testing on it and doesn't stop dashes once they've already started. So you can dash through the miasma. You can't dash in the miasma. So one very interesting thing is Vi, we haven't seen it for a long while, but you actually can't reactivate your Q. So you keep charging up and then you just fizzle out and nothing happens. So.
Right, and in this game here, let's say Lissandra is in the middle of the Cassiopeia W. She actually can't claw out of it because she can't reactivate it. Because she's grounded, which is weird because grounded is not used on a lot of spells, but it basically just means that you can't dash or blink out of it.
Yeah.
So if you're stuck in it, you can't dash and blink. You can only run out of it, and you're slowed down, obviously.
But what is useful is if you are teleporting out, you can interrupt the animation with Miasma from Cassiopeia. So that is actually a very practical application.
Yeah, sadly,
well, this game. Well, in side lane with Parang, never, but.
But it is a situation where if Giants can see the ward that Parang is TPing to, mm-hmm. you put down the Miasma on the ward, and Parang actually can't jump in and claw towards you.
Can't flash, he can't
No,
claw.
You force him there. He can only ult himself. Or ult someone else if they're running to him, but he can't really properly flank if you can see the ward So that means Rocket needs to move the walls a little bit further away when they're TPing in, and wow, 22 minutes.
22 minutes.
First dragon.
Just because Knight can solo it. Giants don't want to commit everyone over there, but now that Giants can take it without taking any damage, and honestly, not a lot of mana hit either, it's absolutely fine. Next dragon is going to be Ocean, as our observers just showed us.
Not very exciting at this point. You want it early game. You don't really want it mid game.
Not right now.
I feel like we're just getting rotten flowers here, so crisis.
Rotten flowers. I've never heard that word used in conjunction with flowers, but I think you're right. Here comes engage from Giants, though, kind of out of nowhere. Betsy is called out and CC'd up, but no one's really doing any damage from now. They are. Erwick comes into the back line. Parang picks up the first kill onto Nine. Ultimate comes in from Parang, but it's not going to do as much right now. Husna will now back away, looking for these Twin Fangs. Sonsdorf from long range is still backing off, opening up. With the curtain call, lands the first, the second onto Parang, looking
incoming.
For the fourth as well, will be knocked up. That's going to take out Raze,
you wanted
who
to be the
steps
hero.
In there as well. And Parang was already out, that would have gone wide. Maxlaw, he's still hunting for some prey, but doesn't have enough damage on that prey seeker. 2-2 trade overall.
Very even fight, and a little bit out of nowhere. Both teams been hovering around mid lane for quite some time, because they're like, we're supposed to fight right now, but we can't really properly start it. And then I believe it was Giant who actually engaged in first, which is not what they want to do with their comp, but let's see the replay. They do get a tower.
So everyone burnt every summoner. Every single summoner
first
was burnt.
First fight
on
in 23 minutes.
No one's been using any summoners, and they just kind of like saw each other in the river and did like Pokemon thing. They made eye contact, and they just like launched at each other and just burnt everything. So yeah, that was interesting. So we're now going to wait another 5 minutes until summoners are back up, and then
because
we'll go again.
Now, the bag is open.
Okay, what's
more
in the
bag?
More
fights will happen. Fights are in the back.
Fights,
and then
right.
I open, they're getting out, you know. Getting in. All
right,
the four, let's
replay
see.
Deficio.
So, it's actually Giants looking to fight here, even though they're technically ones who want Rugger to engage on them. And Knight takes a lot of damage, the great ulti from Airways in the back line. Beautiful play from him, and Parang follows, so really good use in the combat. Look, Pulse. More fighting
in the bag. Huslin is going to try and get away, but he's going to be ulted by Parang. They'll pick up a fast kill onto the support and the mid tower. Rocket get a good advantage and will equalize the game.
Giants are trying to move Knight to the side lane, but he doesn't have TP on his Cassiopeia. And again, so much hard engage from Rocket. That's really risky to do, and that sets up this push on the mid tower. Dead even in gold.
Yep.
24 minutes in. Good statement right there.
Thank you,
Call me Sherlock Holmes. That's what I do.
You know, what I haven't been impressed by so far is Knight's Cassiopeia, because I was incredibly hyped for this, because I've seen it before in other regions when he's been playing, and then he picked up Cassiopeia, and it's like he's going to make some sick plays. And so far, had two okay ultimates. Like, the first one hit the back of Betsy, and the last team fight didn't really hit anyone.
So your definition is if you just hit the back, it's okay?
It's
and
okay.
If you stun, it's great. So you go
well,
from great to okay.
People, yeah.
Okay, that's fair.
I mean, that's what I wanted to see. Like, we saw that highlight clip of him in mid lane outplaying three people at the same time.
Yeah. See, that's the problem about highlight clips, right?
You never live up to the hype.
Yeah, you get very high expectations. You expect more. It's not real always. It's not how real life always is.
Yeah.
You know, highlight clips, it could have been him in 500 games.
Oh, it this composition wasn't. Played to perfection. What that hit! Nice hitbox, and he just goes down. He has another shot as well ready, but kind of just like
more
clipped his arm and just like took him out.
Did a lot more damage than I expected. It wasn't even a crit, it was just a second shot.
All right, goodbye, Raze.
Takes down Raze, and let's see. Rocket can still technically engage on this one. They are in here. It's only the support who's dead, but it is risky. Knight is setting up that wave on top side. Sunstar's been pretty good on this Jhin here, landing some good ulties.
That's what I'm saying, man. These lower performing ADCs are performing so well on Jhin. But also a good setup from Maxwell. He lands the Prey Seeker, which allowed Sunstar to follow up with the Deadly Flourish, but it was still good.
That's why we like these long-range abilities with Jhin. Like, don't just pick Jhin out of nowhere, but stuff like this. Great setup. That's the first, so that's also through the shield. Man, that is way more damage
so
than I expected.
Damage.
Obviously, I guess a Thunderlord proc as well, because you had the
that's
W
true.
Into the ulti and then second shot. And when you do have some good AD early
you've got
on.
300, yeah, so that makes sense. All right.
That was the thing we missed.
I get it. Still a lot of damage, because like he probably would have done something, because he had Flash and he had other abilities, and he could have flashed out of it, but he's like, I can take one more shot before dodging the final one. And maybe by then, someone could body block for him, because he was running to his team. So yeah, got to respect the Thunderlords, man, even in this mid game. Knight taking this one away as well. And we're starting to get more and more items, starting to hit like two item spikes on people, which is really nice for the likes of Hecarim, who can get shut down in the early game and just jump in and die, but now he's a lot harder to take out. Now he's got Cinderhulk and Spirit Visage. Top lane doing rumble things where you just go spell penetration after you got your predator belt. That is the build.
It's pretty simple.
Yeah, you just type in spell penetration in the shop and then you just click everything that comes up. And there you have rumble build.
I'm just rewatching how much damage he did exactly.
Okay.
On the last one. So he had 480 HP and then he got hit by Thunderlords and a second hit. So that was 480 damage from Sunstar.
Well, every time again. Again, Raze. No, this time you have Flash. Yeah, that was probably a good choice. But you got Wall to go. Seal back has to take it. Airwax is trying to come in there.
What a hero.
Yeah, man. Yeah, Raze definitely respected that ultimate a little more this time. Betsy's going to find Max, so he's going to land a full combo as well. In comes the Torment, and now Betsy will back off.
I mean, Sunstar is loving this game because no one is really doing anything against him.
No, Rocket, I mean, it's a Jhin dream, right? You can just sit at range and just launch all your abilities.
Rocket has one random pink ward at the blue buff of Giants, and that's it. There's nothing else behind Giants, yeah. So there's no threat of a TP flank followed by a Hecarim with the late game Ghost just charging in his face. No. He has the river for himself, he has the mid lane for himself, and he just sits there, waits for Max Lord to land a little Prey Seeker, and then he just starts flying away. That's Baron being started with a Cassiopeia, by the way. That's quick.
It goes down real fast. Rumble also
risky.
Came in here
it
with the Flame Spitter, but now everyone's coming in from Rockhat looking for this engage. Onslaught, the Shadows onto a three, but it's smites away by Max Lord. Betsy's gonna get right into the middle of everyone from Giants, but there's
He's
a good
dead.
Ultimate from Knight. He'll shut him down. That's another kill onto Steelback, and Airwax is trying to get onto Max Lord, but Parang's gonna have to go golden. Well, Airwax doesn't have anything to do. He's gonna have to try and do something. Launches onto Sansa. He'll flash away, coming in for the double kill. That's a 5-for-1 for Giants.
Such a great call from Giants. A big issue for them in the past with these Baron calls where they would go at wrong times. But this one, honestly a good call because they would get a fight no matter what and their composition wants Rocket to dive onto them. Secure the Baron. You have a Cassiopeia. She can really burst it down quickly. Sunstar as well able to pick up more kills. Remember, we talked about this earlier. It's armor penetration in your masteries. That's one of the reasons you go with Thunderlords for the flat armor pen. Armor penetration in your build, in your runes. So when you hit the mid to early late game and you have these two or three items all giving you armor penetration, you do so much damage. Especially also because on the side of Rocket, you look at Airwax here, he's building magic resistance. So no one can really tank the damage from Sunstar. So the good call from Giants, take the Baron just in time. And now Sunstar's just outside of the pit. No one is even hitting him. He just crits Steelback for 728. He's like, yeah, hello.
Sunstar's having such a good fight. Look at him, he's just standing still and hitting people for ridiculous amounts of damage. I actually wonder how much damage Sunstar did in that fight. Everyone just pops.
I just feel like all of Rocket, they just don't see him. They're like, where's everyone else on the side of Giants? Let's dive in on Max Law, Smitty J, Knight, kill these guys. And Sunstar just stood outside the Baron pit. He's like, pop, pop, pop. Oh, crit ready. Oh, is that Sealback? 728 damage. Yeah. Dead. There we go. And you win the team fight. Duskblade now completed for him as well. Love it.
Here it comes. Love it. So much damage comes out from that.
He needs a QSS though.
Item.
Instead of another crit item, he should just get QSS now.
Nah, he just needs more crit, more damage. Just go ham.
The only way he can die right now is if Perang gets onto him, ults him, and then just goes down in like one rotation.
You're right. I mean, like, he already has enough damage. He's got 66 flat penetration, which is true damage to Steelback, Raze, and almost Airwax. Betsy and Perang are the only ones with more than 100 armor. So Sunstar is literally doing true damage with his auto attacks and abilities. So quite scary.
And it's interesting. Rocket has put focus on getting magic resist, yet they have not picked up a locket, which is the best for your team you could have done. Instead, straight Mikhail's from Raze just against the snare from Sunstar and the stun from Knight. That is not worth it. That should have been a locket, 100%.
No, I don't disagree with you, Martin. Giants do get hit up by the Never move, but there's no real engage right now. Giants are going to come in here, try and get some long-range poke out from Sunstar. They can get a bit of damage down in the snare. Maybe they can get a pick. Airwax taking a lot of damage. He's actually not that tanky compared to the massive amount of damage coming in from Giants.
And this comp here from Rocket that relied so much on getting ahead early with Swain, with Hecarim, these picks now are just so weak because they're set behind. Airwax is trying to get a Trinity Force as his third fully completed item. You're 0-1. Like, you just got full tank at that point. You abandon the third Trinity Force. I know you love it. I know it's fantastic, but late game, that single item won't make much of a difference. So you just have these champions that couldn't really afford falling behind. They lost these mid-game fights, small fights.
Uh-oh.
Betsy taking damage.
Another curtain call coming in from Sansa. Three shots, four shots.
Onto Raze, he's going to body block. He wants to flash away. He was not really the right person to body block right there, I've got to be honest. Giant's going to use Maxwell to tank up this tower, and Sansa will take pot shots and eventually take it down. Betsy's going to have to back away, taking all these harpoons to the face from Smitty. Beatrice goes down. He's going to scare him away. Good job, Beatrice.
Eric's trying to look for a potential flank, but there are wards on him. He's going to ghost up here. He's going in now. Pause. Get ready. Get
good. Hustling. Looking for that ultimate coming out from Hecarim. He's not going to come in just yet. Paran comes in from the front door, and Giants are all together trying to chunk him down. They take him out, but now here comes Betsy. Do they have the damage?
Sunstar,
he's still kicking. He goes down along with Hustlin, and Razor looking to put up some damage as well, but Maxdor, he's onto Betsy, and this is a very messy fight. A 3-for-2 advantage Giants. Maxdor had his Guardian Angel burn.
Always like to see items like GA when you're winning. Get it, because it just means in these fights here, taking him down twice is already hard enough killing you once. You see here, Rocket had to invest everything after Sunstar went down. That means Giants will still win the fight. I like the flank, I like the engage, but they're going for Steelback.
Flash, he still had
calm
the combo.
Down, everyone.
Goodbye, Steelback.
Was that a cooldown in the last fight?
I have no idea, but what I know for certain, the Steelback is dead. He still had Flash. But yeah, I don't get in range of Rek'Sai.
But
that happens.
Man, Pulse Arena. Rocket fell behind. They had a great engage, honestly. They got onto Sunstar a little bit delayed. Mm-hmm. Managed to take him out. So let's see. Where's Smitty J and his old team this one? It is on cooldown, it looks like. But so they get onto Sunstar in the end. But now Knight is just left untouched. There's always one damage dealer from Giants left untouched. And Rocket is just not tank enough because they're falling behind to kill that one guy. Survive the damage from the other one, then switch later. So it's always like invest everything to kill one and then go down. So if they go for Knight, we're gonna be like, oh, look at Sunstar, he's open, he's free, he's killing them. And if they kill Sunstar, well, we look at Knight being like, oh, look at Knight, he's just machine gunning away, he's killing them. And they just, they Trinity force Hecarim when you're behind, nope, that's a no-go, never do that. Swain when he falls behind, not a strong pick, that's a no-go. And then suddenly you have a composition that doesn't really have any answers. Mm-hmm. You need Giants now to completely mess up a fight, which has happened in the past. So
yes,
it's definitely not over yet. Do not tune away yet, because this game
still
could go completely wrong. 42nd Baron. Last week, 45 minutes in, Giants were winning. It was great. We were praising them. Everyone were happy. Then 45 minutes, they went for Baron. Didn't set up for it at all. Just rushed to Baron. Gilead stole it, won the team fight, won the game for Schalke.
Yeah, they went full Noah's Ark. They went in like 2x2 and just constantly died.
Completely.
And then they just lost the game. And it was like, oh, okay.
Pretty sure in Noah's Ark, they don't walk in 2x2 and die.
No, they make it out alive.
Yeah, I feel like your story there is
a little bit flawed, perhaps.
Maybe.
Yeah, perhaps. Maybe.
You have your own story.
I do, yeah. I'm breaking the mold. There we go. Rewriting history. Rocket trying to rewrite this game, but yeah, it was weird for my Airwax though. He was hanging around the back of the fight. It's like, here comes the ultimate, here comes the ultimate. And then the front engages first, and I'm like, okay.
Yeah, you need Parang also to be able to flank, right?
Yeah.
Parang actually has to go in first, technically, and then Airwax follows. Baron is being started. This time, look how Giants are setting up a lot more safe around the Baron.
Good zoning ult from Hustlin. Smitty J's
also
trying to zone away.
Nope.
Airwax comes in, tries to get the smite, doesn't happen.
Now he's alone now.
He's in way too deep. Giants are just going to obliterate him. Betsy is going to go into the Zhonya's Hourglass. Steelback's going to run away. Betsy gets taken down. 3-0. Giants get everything they wanted.
Like, Rocket in this game are simply not able to coordinate engages. Steelback, he's going to try and run, but Parang wasn't even in that fight. He didn't even join in time.
Nope. Steelback's going to... Oh, Smitty J's going to chase him down. I think it might just speed the game here, DiPizio. Knight and the rest of the team are just pushing in. They have all these minions.
You know it's going to be game when the cams come up.
Yeah, they're like, take them down. Game's not ending. But no, it's going to be the game here. Parang's the only one remaining. He's going to pop the ultimate on himself, try and buy some time. But he's literally just scratching the surface, really, on Giant's health bars. And they're going to focus the Nexus itself. Parang goes down, padding the stats, earning those fancy points. And that's game one over to Giants.
Apart from, I want to say like 1 fight in the mid game, I actually felt like Giants were in full control.
Yeah.
All game long, they were setting up much better around Barons. Obviously, we would have loved to see an earlier Dragon, but that's a small thing. That's obviously not that important at this point. But Giants showed in these team fights that their comp where you had to run at them was much easier for them to execute. I actually felt like Rocket's comp in terms of starting a fight should be easy enough. Mm-hmm. But not once did we see the Lissandra and Hecarim synergized in terms of engage. Like, both of them were technically what we like to call follow-up engage and not
primary engage.
Primary engage, the first guy who's in, that's like a Maokai who just like rushes in.
Sure.
Both Hecarim and Lissandra do well when someone can follow, and they really struggle if no one can follow. Mm-hmm. So they had to be ready, both of them. Parang and LX in these fights were never really able to coordinate properly. And then your comp falls behind even
further.
Much.
I mean, the irony of the whole thing was just like, oh, why aren't Giants going for Dragons? But that actually just didn't give Rocket any chance ever to get like a TP flank on them because they just didn't go for Cloud Dragon. And then it was so weird. Like, the first first fight of the game was just both of them just like making eye contact and River and just like all going in. I was like, okay.
And there's Giants just randomly running in. It's like, well, we've been here for 25 minutes. The casters are probably waiting for some fights.
We have a lot of summoners.
Let me just
roll my head on the keyboard.
Rush in.
Let's go.
But this pick and ban phase as well from Rocket, there were question marks. Swain first pick in Europe is not something we see very often. I don't think it's something where Giants will go, oh, boo-hoo-hoo, we don't get to first pick our own Swain. Like, it's kind of like, all right, sure.
Yeah, you can let it through. I mean, it's one of those things, right? Like, Betsy can go huge on the pick and be like, yeah, what a great first pick, giving it
and
over to Betsy.
Risk.
Or you can just have a game like this where it falls behind and then doesn't do Swain things. So it's obviously a risk, right? Especially as a first pick.
It's high risk, high reward, especially after the nerfs where he just no longer is as strong as he used to be. Other things, the Hecarim pick. I think Hecarim is a good pick, but I think you need to be able to execute mid game 100%. You cannot afford falling behind. He's also a bit like Swain. If Hecarim falls behind, he doesn't get to go Trinity Force. He suddenly loses a lot of his value as a backline threat, and he just becomes a pure tank, which is okay too if you didn't have someone running in with the Hecarim, because he can never on his own kill the backline.
Yeah.
Like, unless he gets super fed, and that's where he can take over games. But Rocket showed lack of coordination and disappointing mid-game, I want to say, and Giants fully deserve to win this game.
I think so too. We're going to take a look at one of the highlights from the last game. It was just a 5-1 at Baron, and by this point, I feel like in the game, Giants had pretty much already won anyway. The game was secured, but this was the final nail in the coffin.
Definitely was, and obviously, Eric, actually, this is the first Baron we had where Giants got the advantage. Where you can see Sunstar outside of the pit now because they're trying to focus Knight. But the Parang just ulted now. The fight is already over. Mm-hmm. Like, it needs to be there instantly. I'm not blaming purely Parang, but like, you need that Lissandra ulti with the Hecarim ulti. Otherwise, I don't see how you win these fights. Because then Swain sits with you when you CC down targets, and he can literally just sustain himself. Because no one can burst him, because you're feared, you're stunned, you're snared. Not in this game.
No.
And we need to see more from Rocket, but I say that because I feel like the Rocket lineup on paper coming into the split was stronger than being number 10.
Yeah.
I think Betsy, Steelback, and Airwax, both, all three had good games. And especially Steelback and Betsy showed up last split.
Yeah.
And Parang and Race were two players from the Korean Challenger scene that looked okay, looked decent. Mm-hmm. There was some hype around them for sure. But this team just, it doesn't work.
No, like, it doesn't. Like, we've given, like, Parang, it just doesn't work. I do want to highlight Sunstar, though, another game on Jhin where he just did really well. And it was just, it worked out so well for him. Like, that last team fight that we saw, he was just like walking around, like, you get an auto attack, and you get an auto attack, and you get an auto attack, and I just did the most damage in the game. And that was it. I almost feel like you need to take the Jhin away from him, because on the other champions that we've seen him on, pretty much everything else, we've been like, it's been like an okay performance,
sure,
or just bad. So
I would definitely
take
remove
that one away.
Definitely remove it, because again, the Rocket clearly didn't have anything else they were too afraid of. Like, if you can first pick a Swain against a team who most likely won't play it, you're clearly not that afraid of their normal strong picks.
Yeah.
But then the Jhin comes in as the first rotation and does really well, so now you should respect it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a fine ban. Or if Giants don't want to first pick it, you can then get it in first rotation as Rocket. If you set up something as a bait and be like, oh, you really want to first pick this one, so we get the Jhin, that's also a possibility. But I definitely think Sunstar should not be allowed to play it.
I agree.
Just because he actually had, like, impact in the mid game, something we don't often see from him, where he struggles early, mid, and then late game. Mm-hmm. He's doing like okay, but Giants are not normally relying on the AD carry to win. It's Smitty J, it's Knight, it's Max Lore.
Yeah, it's the triangle.
The Holy Trinity.
The Holy Trinity of Giants. Yeah, Knight did well in the end. I mean, he did everything he had to. He didn't have to make the highlight play. He just went ham and just killed everyone. So, yeah, really well played from Giants. We'll see what they bring out onto the table for the next game. But we are going to toss it over to Pyro, who's going to break down game one of Splice and UOL.
Thank you very much, Pulse. Now, Well, Rocket, and Giants.